on your shirt. It's not,
yeah, that's
you know, where we live, it's so different.
No, you're hot.
So Don's got it.
Special day where God's going to join them together in holy matrimony. I think most of you know the backstory of how we all got here. We'll talk about that as we go through the service, but it's a wonderful day, a day to brag about God's grace and the story of redemption. So I want to start with a word of prayer. Let's bow our hearts and our minds. Lord, we're so amazed that your favor and your grace shines upon us. Lord, life is hard to navigate at times. Lord, this side of heaven, very difficult to find peace in all circumstances, Lord, but you said that your word was a light unto your path. And Lord, you have brought light to this situation, redemption. So Lord, as we go through the service, we know that you're our honored guest. You're going to bring this couple together in holy matrimony. And we thank you for the folks who have gathered, the community to support this couple this day. And we give you all the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. You can all be seated. So I think most of you know that Bruce and Deb lost their spouses some time ago. And share with me, they really never had any intention of being married again. And they met each other, believe it or not, at a grief share program that the Fran and Carol lead. They're here today at our church. And somehow God brought them to this decision this day that they'll be united in holy matrimony. They decided to do something that I've never seen before at a wedding, but I think is amazing, and that's to honor their spouses. So I believe Sandra's going to light a candle, and she'll light the first candle.
Reading. Cobbling it, I guess. I knew it.
Right. Yeah, so she'll light one, and then Bruce is going to talk about Jean.
Jean was a very good wife and mother. She took a young man that was definitely a lump of coal.
You?
Yes, me. And worked a lot of years to polish, and I think she did a great job. And God worked in mysterious ways with her and me to give us a beautiful daughter. And she's going to be missed dearly by us all.
Thank you. And we'll light the second one. You'll talk about Gary.
My beloved, my first love, gave me four beautiful children and daughters-in-laws and grandchildren, and he will always be a part of me. I will always wear his ring, our wedding rings, as a symbol of my eternal love. for him. And he is dearly missed. I love you.
Whew. Amazing. The couple will now state their declaration of intention to be joined in the holy matrimony. So Bruce, we'll begin with you. There's nothing to repeat. Just say I do or I will at the end. If you're so inclined. I, Bruce, take thee, Deb, to my lawfully... Will you, Bruce, do you take Deb to be your lawfully wedded wife?
I do.
Wait, there's more. There doesn't need to be more, it's just a formality. Will you live with her in the state of holy matrimony according to Christian ordinance? Will you love her, honor her, and keep her as long as both of you shall live?
I do.
Okay. And Deb, will you take Bruce to be your lawfully wedded husband? Will you live with him in the state of holy matrimony according to Christian ordinance? Will you love him, honor him, and keep him as long as both of you shall live? Okay. So in a few seconds, we'll do the vows. And gosh, do vows mean any more to us than on this day? I had a wedding last week, a very young couple. And, I mean, the vows are the last thing on their mind, right? They have all the wedding planning and the perfect day. And here's a couple that shared vows years ago, and they kept them for better or worse, for richer or poorer, sickness and health, till death do us part. That's a beautiful thing. It's a wonderful thing. I mean, it's so lacking in our culture, and you know all the statistics. So, before we get to those vows, I think we're going to read scripture. So, I think those people know who they are. Okay.
Hear God's word from Psalm 145, 6 and 7. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all that he has made. The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and loving toward all he has made. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him. The Lord watches over the alien and sustains the fatherless and widow. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up all their wounds. And from Isaiah, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to comfort all who mourn, and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you. That reading really, really describes life. And while we're here, I just want to add a very short piece of scripture that I've never, ever read at a wedding. Most of the time I actually read it at a funeral, believe it or not. It's Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and if you're not familiar with scripture, this was put to a popular song. But to everything there is a season and a time and a purpose under a heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to kill, a time to mourn, a time to dance. It goes on. And then it says God's made everything beautiful in its time. And a little backstory here. The writer of Ecclesiastes is Solomon. He's the wisest man to ever live. He wrote 4 books of the Bible, 3,000 Proverbs, 1,000 Psalms. And he was the son of David. And he took all of this wisdom and he went on a quest to find the meaning of life. And we live in an age where people do that, right? Philosophers, movie stars, rock stars, people with money. You know, they're trying to find out, how do you make sense of life? And Solomon did this, and he had the wherewithal. He had the money, the power. And in the book of Ecclesiastes, he tells us right in the beginning that life is meaningless. This is in the Bible. Life is meaningless. It's vanity. It's like chasing after the wind. You can't hold on to anything. Even whenever you amass, you leave to somebody else. It's a cruel trick, Solomon said. But he came to that conclusion, and God allowed it in the Bible, because he looked at life under the sun. He looked at life without God in the equation. But in this chapter, he comes to his senses, and he plugs God in. He says, now I see life under heaven, and everything has a purpose, And God has made everything beautiful in its time. And basically what he tells us is we're going to go through the seasons of life. So we're all going to have those wonderful days at the hospital where a child was born. We're all going to attend funerals. We're all going to mourn. We're all going to dance. In my opinion, the good times outweigh the bad. But this is what we're called to do in a fallen world. We go through the seasons of life. And God's put eternity in our hearts. And that's the story of redemption here, is that this isn't the end of the story. And God has brought this couple together. Why? Because in Genesis it says it's not good that the man or the woman should be alone, right? All of us here understand that. We all were created to have a relationship with God, eternity in our hearts. But we were all created to know some other human being in an intimate way. The mingling of souls, the sharing of each other's innermost world. And that's something for the last several years that was lacking in Bruce and Deb's life that God has beautifully put together. And that's why we honored the spouses, and that's why we're all here today. This is a story of redemption. There's a verse Christians like to quote in Romans 8. It says, God works all things for good. And I think a lot of Christians mean, well, all things should be good in my life. And it's really the opposite. You know, all bad things can happen to Christians, and have. All bad things. Because if you read the end of the chapter, it says, there's nothing that will separate us from the love of Christ, not peril, sword, famine, or nakedness. That means we can go through all those things, and probably will. Jesus said that in this life we will go through tribulation. But listen to this. He said, but I've overcome the world. And so God has made all things good today. It doesn't erase the past. It doesn't help us understand this side of heaven, what happened years ago. But for this one day, he's given us purpose, and he's made all things beautiful. And I always tell my congregation, never judge God in a snapshot. Never look at circumstances today. Wait 10, 15, 20 years and look back. And even though you can't make sense of it all, the beautiful thing is he walks with us and gives us joy. And Bruce said, somebody asked Bruce today, how do you feel? He said, I feel happy. And that's the Spirit of God. So I'm happy for you guys. And as we read in the sharing of the Word of God, I know you guys are going to build your house on the rock. And that's the most important thing. So you guys ready for the vows?
One more reading.
Okay.
You'll like it
better. I thought it was all combined into one. Yeah.
So, Ecclesiastes. 4:9 and following.
Two are better than one.
They are. Because they have a good return for their labor.
Right. One falls, the other picks up.
Well, if either of them falls down, one can help the other up.
Right.
But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken.
Okay, Bruce, you can look at Deb, and now you will repeat after me, and we'll go slow.
Right.
Hi, Bruce.
Hi, Bruce.
Take thee, Deb. To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To have and to hold. From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or worse.
Better or worse.
For richer or poorer.
Richer or poorer.
In sickness and health.
Sickness and health.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
Amen. Deb, you can share this with Bruce and repeat after me. I, Deb, take thee, Bruce, to be my lawfully wedded husband, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or worse,
for richer or poorer,
sickness and health,
till death do us part.
Amen. Are we doing rings?
Yes.
Okay. So Bruce, we'll start with you. You could slide the ring halfway up Deb's finger and repeat after me. In token and pledge.
Of our constant faith.
And abiding love. With this ring.
I thee wed.
Name the Father.
And of the Son.
And Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Deb, you can take the ring and slide it halfway up Bruce's finger. In token and pledge
of our constant faith
and abiding love.
With this ring,
I thee wed. In the name of the Father,
Father,
and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for bringing this couple together. Lord, we thank you that these witnesses can be here. Lord, this is a mystery, Paul said, the joining together as one flesh. Lord, it's a bond only you can do. It's a miracle of heaven. Lord, I pray for this couple. I pray that all their days they would walk with you. And Lord, as C.S. Lewis said, life is a journey. There's a series of inns along the way, places we never dreamed we'd go. But you're with us. So I pray for Bruce and I pray for Deb. In Jesus' name, amen. Ladies and gentlemen, we have all gathered here today. We've heard a declaration of this couple's intention to be joined together in holy matrimony. As a minister of the gospel, with the power vested in me by the state of Pennsylvania, I now pronounce this couple man and wife. You may kiss the bride.
I might block you away. Giving up on finding the one that I could fall into. The day before, I was ready to settle for less than love and not much more. There was no such thing as a dream come true. All of that was on the day before you.
Raise your glasses, please. Deborah and Deb.
I have no glasses.
Two people who have weathered their own storms and then found each other, then weathered a few more storms as their love grew. May the warmth of God's love shine down upon you and bring you and your family many blessings in the years ahead. God bless your marriage and bind you together in love, for we know that a cord of three strands is not quickly broken. To Deborah and Bruce.
Deborah? You're here.
There we go.
I want to hear this. You got to wrap around. There you go.
It seems like forever ago now, back when my dad and I first began our journey with Grief Share. When he pointed out someone across the table and told me, if he were to ever date again, he'd want a woman to be like her. That woman, I'm sure you're all aware, or have guessed, was Deb Davis at the time. It took a few more weeks, along with the help of his wingman, me, for him to have the courage to give her his digits and ask if she'd like to get together sometime. I'm sure everyone can imagine the look of a high school girl lying on her bed on the phone with somebody she's got a crush on, twirling the cord. Well, I kid you not, this was my dad. The outdated phone cord, of course. So far, it's been a wild ride, to say the least. But I feel together these two can handle anything life throws at them. Congratulations.
Now the couple would like to share with their guests.
Thank you so much for coming today. You all have been an integral part of our lives, and we wouldn't be here today without you. Thank you, Pastor Bob, for officiating, and Monica, so grateful to God for you and for your church, for Carol and Fran, who brought Grief Share to us. I went to Pastor Steve's office. I said, we need Grief Share in my church. I want it in my church with widows that know the Lord. He kicked a box on his feet. He said, look at that box. Grief Share books. He said, you've got to meet Carol and Fran. They're going to start one. So we were in their first Grief Share. And several weeks later, along came Bruce and Sandra. And it was wonderful. Wonderful journey together that God not only healed our hearts and helped us move on. So Cindy has been my wingman, and thank you for all your support and encouragement. Doug, David, and Jen, when I lost my husband, you know, they helped us move, they helped us pack, they helped fix up the kitchen. I mean, they just, and now they're helping me, us now, so thank you, family. Our sons, Matt and Josh and Mace and their wives. They've been wonderful, and I'm so glad to share this day with you. Aaron for doing the music, and Lori for the beautiful flowers. But to my new husband, who turned my sorrow into joy. All these scriptures read today fulfilled in my life. I thank God for you. And for the Lord, you are true to your word, Lord, and you have never failed me. I love you.
You want me to say all I can say is thank you all for being here for Deb and I. You've really made today super special. I mean, it's been a really, really crazy life. You lose somebody and you do get broken, and you're so broken, and you just don't ever think there's a spot of light. And Deborah came into my life, and not only was it a light, but it was a beacon in the darkness, and it just kept getting brighter and brighter. Pretty soon I was blinded by all that. That bright light, and I had a smile on my face. And going to Grief Share, Fran and Carol, and our church, it has shown me that everybody, you know, everybody in your life and God are so important. And, you know, if we just, like, pray and, you know, care about each other and do what we can, I let it in God's hands mostly, because that's how I run my life anymore, because I have no control over anything. Things come out really good. I couldn't stop my way. And, you know, I didn't try. I just prayed that God would make everything all right. And God has blessed me a hundredfold. More than, they told me a long time ago, more than your wildest dreams, what you hang on, you're in for a ride. More than your wildest dreams to be able to handle. And I didn't know it, but I take the faith, and I believed them, and they were absolutely right. Thank you, everybody, for being here for us.
Be nice, Rich.
You're going to want a bigger piece, Bruce.
No.
Oh, it's red.
Delegated, yeah. And we can't take it out.
Come on, Bruce, you're not gutting a deer.
You'd be faster.
Might be able to do that a little easier. You're bigger. Ah, there you go. Your thought?
That's it.
It's like sweet. You gotta get all the.
Yeah, I know.
Here
you go. I appreciate it.
There you go. Made it.
What did you do? Diet Coke. Yeah.
Yeah, we should have had Dr. Pepper on one of you. You are the Dr. Pepper queen.
Thank you. Aww. You guys are great.
That's crazy. Thank you, everybody. Am I going to get a ticket driving down the road with this?
If I get arrested,
you got a good excuse.
I think you can. Yeah, they seem just married on it.
Bye.
Enjoy.
Bye.
See you guys. Drive careful. Have fun.
Don't go into Bethlehem.
Don't get too pruned up. Yeah. We don't want to see you on 69 News.
Stay away from running.
Got a beep.
Does this grow bald since we're on boats?
Oh, they're cute. See you guys. Be safe.
Be safe.
Oh, my God.